And I'm going to be talking about escape room games, real world escape room games, because I've made one. And as I was coming, writing this talk today, I was like, oh, I think I've been to like lots of VideoBrains now, and the talks that I like the most are the talks where people talk about something that they really love and kind of really geek out over. I found that if I was to try and recite a love letter to my own work in front of you all, my ego might self-destruct and take out all of Dalston and all you lovely people as well, so I just can do it. So instead, what I'm going to do is talk about all the things that I love, really, really love, and how I poured those into this particular project, where they kind of came out in the project at all. So, let's see how I'm going to do this.
Yes!
Okay, so, real world escape room games. One thing that I did discover from having made one of these games, the main thing I discovered is that no one can understand how I pronounce the word room. Everyone keeps saying, like, oh, what do you mean? Yeah, it's a room escape game. And I'm like, room escape? That's interesting. What kind of game is that? Like, I don't know, but it does sound cool. So if anyone would like to make a game called Room Escape, then we're totally going to play it. Yeah, it sounds awesome. We didn't make one of those. We made a real world escape room game. And what that is, I'm going to have a show of hands. Who has played or has heard of a room escape game in this room? Excellent, that's pretty much everyone. Well, that doesn't matter, because I'm still going to explain what it is anyway. It's like one of those kind of like point and click adventure games that were flash games in the 90s, where you're in a room and there's lots of puzzles kind of scattered around the walls and things, and you kind of go through all those puzzles in a chain until finally you figure out the one thing that will unlock the door and you escape. It's like one of those, however, you're in an actual physical room. Your actual friends and actual physical objects that you're picking up and playing with and figuring stuff out, and it's far more exciting and really cool. I think probably the most obvious thing that this sounds like, that is a first influence, is the Crystal Maze! I made this game in America. So I was living out in Portland in Oregon on the west coast of America, between Seattle and San Francisco. It's where they keep the hipsters. So we made this game in America, and half the team, because it wasn't just me, half the team were American and half the team were English. Having to explain what the Crystal Maze is to the people who would come from a culture where it doesn't exist, they just were getting really confused look in their face every time during a meeting. Half the group would go du-du-du-du-du-du-du. Talk about harmonicas. So we had to like sit them down, make them watch. So the Crystal Maze was a television program in the 90s where a team of people would follow this excellently dressed man around whilst he played the harmonica, took him to different kinds of little rooms where they had 2 minutes to solve a puzzle. And then they would go to the Crystal Dome and try and grab shiny bits of paper and not grab other shiny bits of paper. And every crystal that they collected as they went around was seconds in the dome. So it was awesome. It was very formative for my childhood and many other people's. There was in fact a Kickstarter recently that successfully funded to make a real Crystal Maze game that's going to happen. So we'll be very excited about that. So this is our team. The American half and the English half. So we have Matthew, Dave, Laura, Jay, myself, and Victor. And together we made a little company called Sight of the Six. We were doing this kind of in our spare time after work as a hobby. And we just decided that we were going to like pool all of our resources to kind of align what our hobbies would be for the next year in order to make this thing. Also our kind of our backgrounds were, I'm a game designer, Jay was also a game designer and a programmer, Laura is an interactive fiction writer, Dave is a graphic designer and fabricator, he likes making things out of wood and metal, and Matt and Victor started this thing called Puzzle Pint, which is one of in London as well, where once a month people will go to a pub, have to solve a puzzle to find out where the pub is, and then go, it's like a pub quiz, so like, these secret groups would appear and you just solve puzzles. It's really fun. So we kind of had these resources of their puzzle experts. Both myself and Jay have worked in small indies in London, were making also reality games. And myself and David have both worked for Punch Drunks, a theatre company, so we were set designers and builders as well. So we have all of these resources. And we all had things that we wanted to get out of this project, so, which I think is the next slide. Yes, so, and of course, myself, Laura, Jay and Dave were four-fifths of our annual kind of, we would get together and do the global game jam together, so we kind of knew that we could successfully get a game made within 48 hours. And we're going to spend way more than 48 hours on this, it'll be easy. Yeah, it took about a year. But we did go through kind of the dev cycle that you ordinarily would for a game. So this is the paper prototype on the stage here. It's the thing on the left is it's a shoebox, made of actual paper. And then we kind of tested that. In fact, the paper prototyping phase was really cool. We turned mine and David's dining room into a paper version of the room. Like, we even papered over the kitchen door so that we could have a secret wall that had they got papered into the kitchen during the playtest, so that he could like pass messages and things, and it looked like a secret surprise magical thing, which was really great. And then we had to cut him out, so at the end. So we did the paper prototype phase, and then the middle phase, which is Jay soldering there, which was the kind of slightly more, we moved up to cardboard. So that's a tea box carton, but with actual electronics that actually did the thing. And then the final phase the final iteration is the real product, which is what Victor is building, which I won't tell you how it works because that would be a spoiler. So this is the formative game for me, Myst. I played so many. That was my grown-up games were point-and-click adventures, Dead and Tentacle, Monkey Island. But the one game that just kind of clicked for me was Myst. And I think it was because, unlike those other point-and-click adventures where you went on big epic sprawling things around all over the world, this one game you just had to kind of wander around in this environment and just find stuff. And I think, if I Googled correctly, I can't remember, but I think this is the puzzle that stuck with me the most, was this one puzzle where you had to go to different areas of the environment and just like look out over the sea and listen to the sound of the sea, or go to this swamp and listen to the frogs croaking, and you had to really pay attention to the environment you were in order to solve this code-breaking puzzle, essentially. So you'd press these buttons and hear these different sounds, but you had to have gone around the environment and actually paid attention to it, which was something that just really struck me, like, wow, that can happen. That's a thing that a game can do. So that's something that I wanted to carry across. So a little bit more about actual Escape from the Room games, the kind of 90s flash version. They didn't stop in the 90s. They carried on going. This one's more recent. This is 2011, 2012, and I can't remember what it's called, but it's by someone called Letter Room. And all of the RuneScape games by Deteru are just kind of fucked up, basically. if you lose, the way that like you can die in this game is that you will walk into a room and there'll be some pandas. And the pandas are kind of like, it's like when he walks in The Shining and there's the man in the suit and you're like, oh god, no, it's the people in the suits and they're going to do something nasty. And every single one of these Deteru games has got this secret, horrific people in costumes moment if you happen to fail. This is a very, I recommend playing this one. This was very weird, like just anything by this person. Also Daymare is my other favourite kind of contemporary Escape the Room games. It's like a nightmare, but everything's in the daylight and you're in this sort of desolate world. And there's little puzzles and stuff, and it's kind of like jump scares, but it's just beautiful. The main difference between these online room escape puzzles and these its physical ones is that on the computer games, it's designed for one person to play. One person is interacting with everything, and you solve the puzzles by yourself, and you've got as much time as you want. In these physical, real-world games, you're in a team. And I mean, even Crystal Maze, one person went and solved the puzzles, and the other shouted incredibly helpful advice through a window. But in our RuneScape game, we wanted, and a lot of the RuneScape games that we played, like in Seattle and New York and San Francisco, they're just kind of collected shitloads of puzzles and put them all in one place. Things were kind of in order a bit, but they mainly you were just kind of like, oh yeah, I'm going to solve this as I can. And like when you came out at the end, you're like, oh yeah, I solved all of this. And somebody else who was on the same team as you was like, I didn't even know that existed. I was like, what? I've been carrying around this monkey wrench shaped banana for the entire game and I didn't know what it was for. So we kind of wanted to not do that. So for our game, we made sure that we had puzzles that could only be solved by a group, and you had to use teamwork for. We also kind of interspersed that with things where everyone split up and go off and do stuff together and then come back, like unroll the pieces of a jigsaw and then assemble the jigsaw, essentially. But then things where you had to have one person over here doing this in order for someone over there to be doing that, so like proper teamwork and communicating. We had our team size be people of eight, groups of eight, so that they could split into smaller groups of four and work on two streams at once. So if people got bored or stuck on one stream, they could switch over to their other team. So we didn't tell them they had to do this, we were just hoping that the groups would naturally fall into these different sizes and do these things. So just to sort of design the puzzle flow in a way that would facilitate a natural kind of team dynamic. Yeah, different kinds of puzzles, activities, which were more... Because that was the other thing, was that my boyfriend Dave is not really into the games and stuff. And when he came with us to do this escape room up in Seattle, he was like, I just really hope there's something on a high shelf so that I can be useful. I didn't want to look bad in front of all the other people. And it was just like, oh, and he ended up solving loads of stuff, but he had that attitude going to it, and he wouldn't have chosen to go if we hadn't dragged him. And so we kind of wanted to make sure that we designed games for people who would come and want to feel like, oh shit, I just contributed a bit. Even if they ended up being really useful, but just so that they would know. Which is what we're calling different player skill sets and play styles. Punch Drunk. So, that thing I mentioned this earlier, this is like my shorthand for massive immersive theatre. So Punch Drunk are a theatre company, and they make these huge immersive sets, like an entire world, basically, where the audience will go up and down on different floors of this building and get kicked out at various points, and normally split up from their friends, and have to just go and try and find the play. The play is wandering in a massive loop, and so you have to go and explore this world that they've built. Ben and I went to play one of these in like 2004, 2005, and just fell in love with it because it's like going into a dream. They're called Punch Drunk because it's like being punched in the side of the head. And your brain just feels like you've been in a dream for the entire time. It's so much fun. And we became hooked. So like in 2006, we decided, oh, let's find out when the next play's on. And there wasn't one on, but on their website they said, hey, if you want to come and help build the set, turn up on this day in this place. So we did. And we ended up building the set from the entire summer, and that we like, got loads of experience doing that, and learned a lot about like how the lighting design can change the way you feel in a room and how you can look at different spaces, and the kind of storytelling that just the set and the props can have without actually having to tell, like physically write down, oh, this is happening. You can just get a sense of like the atmosphere of what kind of space you're in. And so we used this in our design for this by Dave really wanted to try and make it feel like film Brazil. Just this sort of, again, because you know, we're aliens in America, like Britishness of bureaucracy and paperwork and austerity. So we kind of using like the lighting, the sound design, to kind of convey this feeling that you'd actually snuck into an office. Oh, and the theming and set of this thing was, we were trying to do something a bit different from any of the room escapes that we'd seen in the US, and so we'd gone for this kind of fictional Soviet Eastern Bloc in the 80s style, paranoia-fueled world where you have the government has a totalitarian regime over everybody, and you are resistance members who are trying to break in and sneak into this office, the Ministry of Ideology, which is the propaganda office, and find out what happened to one of your plants that had gone missing. So you're breaking into this guy's office, and you are sort of sneaking around. You have this horrible feeling that I really shouldn't be here, which is like very much conveyed through the kind of oppressive environment. This is one of the teams that played finding something, and so another game that like, strongly inspired me in that why I wanted to make that kind of themed game was from playing Papers, Please. Just this sort of sense of unease of like, should I really be doing what I'm doing in here? It's like, yeah, sort of, there's this system in place in this world, but do I really want to be part of it? And if you don't know Papers, Please, then you should play it because it's really good. And I'm going to run out of time if I describe everything. Another game, so this game in particular, I just loved. It's a game called Black Bar, and all you're doing is going through these conversations and trying to figure out. So it's this kind of correspondence between two people, and some of the words have been redacted, and you have to type in what the redacted words are. And it's directly inspired one of the puzzles that's in the room. But this, again, it's this sort of feeling of there are people's lives being actually affected in everything that you're kind of just doing by rote, because the game told you to do, you kind of have this uneasy feeling. So we try to put that into the puzzle design. These games here, so I'm calling it haptic games, which is a really ugly phrase, and I apologise. Haptic just means kind of physical touching stuff, which only really matters, and you only really need that word if you're translating that into a virtual space. So it's kind of the opposite of what this is. So the other thing that I just really wanted to have in this game is this feeling that you're playing with stuff, you're touching actual objects, and these objects do magical things. They've got Arduinos inside them, and special effects and magic tricks, like you build something over here and suddenly that thing over there opens and switches on. You're like, what the hell? That shouldn't happen. So these games, which both these pictures are from the Out Control exhibition that was at GDC 2 years ago. This game is Waffle Pillar, Roll on the Floor Laughing Pillar, because you are the controller. You're inside a sleeping bag that's like a caterpillar, with a cord on your belly button, and you have to actually roll and pull this cord in order to control the character. You can see your character, and you're trying to eat apples before the other caterpillar does, who's on the other side, also lying on the floor, rolling around in a sleeping bag. You're looking inside, you've got your head on the floor, looking inside the roof of the Wendy house, where you can see the two caterpillars that you're controlling. And then also we've got Bonus Look. Yes, Bonus Look is a two-player game where one person can, you're a wizard, and one person has only got the direction arrows, and the other person on the other side is just looking at a wooden screen, and they can see the maps of the areas with different words. So you have to kind of say, I'm in this area and I can see the word which way, and then that person has to type the letters in order to make gates, but I don't explain it very well. Anyway, that game's cool. Look at that. That was the major thing in this RuneScape game, is we're actually building physical things, and there's just something a bit different between. I've made lots of different kinds of games. I've made board games, I've made iPad games, computer games, and running around in the street, that kind of like pervasive games, the auto-reality games, all these different kinds. And this is the kind of most satisfying one, is when you're actually building physical objects for me and for my interests. This was the first one of these that I built where there's woodwork involved. This is Dave and our friend Colin, who we met at Burning Man. So he's good at building stuff. And that was the other nice thing, just roping in people to play it. Like, we got the, people get excited about this. Like, people are like, oh yeah, this sounds really cool. This guy, he worked on the lighting design of Grimm, the TV show, which is filmed in town. Like, get him involved. And like, yeah, sure. And we like paid him $100, which is about 70 quid, and he did the whole thing for us. Yeah, it was just, yeah. People did it because they thought it sounded fun and cool, which was just so gratifying. The kind of obligatory, this is what the room looked like before we installed it. That's the door, it's a piece of tape on the floor. And that's how it started. We got to do lots of cool shit, like green screening. Like, we would, yeah, that would not normally happen for me on the project. And Screen Talk Saturday, it's a bit different. So I'm like, oh, like looking at everyone else, like, look at all of our screenshots. Like, I'm mopping a floor in a warehouse in downtown Portland. But it ended up looking really cool, and we're really proud of it. If you happen to go to Portland in Oregon, or if you know someone who would like to play this, then the game's called Spark of Resistance. It is a real-life room escape game. The URL is 60minutestoescape.com. Over here in England, I've now teamed up with Gareth Briggs, and we are going to start our own project, which we'd love to find out more about if you follow enter_ oubliette. So that's my talk.